Okay, I'd like to call this meeting to order of the Assiniboia Community Committee for Tuesday, October 18th, 2016. I'm here with our esteemed clerk, Ms. Watt, Councillor Sean Dobson, Councillor Scott Gillingham, and trusted members of the public service, Mr. Clark, Rack, and James. May I have a motion with respect to the minutes of the of our last
so moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Number one in our reports is a per capita grant for the Assiniboine Golf Course.
Yes, Mr. Chair. Assiniboine Golf Course, the city-owned golf course right now, it's run on a lease agreement managed by a third party. But Assiniboine Golf Course, actually, in 2017, coming up in a few months, will be celebrating their 100th anniversary, their years of existence. I didn't know until the other night that it, at one time it was a 27-hole course. Now it's a 9-hole course. Anyways, this is to assist with, they've got some really great plans. This $100 is just to assist them with some of the planning and preparation to celebrate their centennial. I'll have more information as the months unfold on that, I would move that we grant them $100 to assist with their anniversary celebrations.
Okay, so moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Next is the per capita grant for the White Ridge Community Center. Councillor Gillingham, I'd be happy if you would.
Sure, be glad to
Assist with the $300.
Yeah, be glad to make a motion to that end then.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Three is the Charles Wadena Church Christmas Hamper Committee. Maybe I'll pass the chair for this one, Councilor Gillingham, to you.
Sure.
This is for the Charles Wood United Church Christmas Hamper Committee has submitted an application for a per capita grant in the amount of $1,000 to assist with the cost of purchasing turkeys for Christmas hampers for families in need in the community. So I'd like to move that we approve this grant.
Moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you.
Leave the chair with you.
Okay.
We have next item. You've got the chair, but it's...
Yeah. Next, yes, yeah. It is item number four. And Councilor Ransom, invite you to speak to it.
It is a an application for land dedication reserve for $20,000 to essentially renovate the playground at the school. And it is something that I support. There's also a separate application, a new business item, which will come forward also. New business, which is, I should talk about them together probably. Where is it?
Yeah, it's this one right here.
Yeah. They've also applied for a community incentive grant for the same project. So they are putting up their own money. It meets criteria. Both applications meet criteria. And so I would...
Or you can suspend the rules now if you want to add the new business items and you can deal with them both. You want to move suspension of the rules?
Yeah,
let's do that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Okay, so that being the case, I'd like to move that we accept item number four, which is a $20,000 grant from Land Education Reserve to assist the Laidlaw School Play Educate Grow Committee with the Laidlaw School Playground Project.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried.
And I'll also move the community incentive grant application, which is
item seven.
Item seven. It's $33,855. Also for the Laidlaw School Playground Improvement Project.
Okay. It is moved. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's carried.
Thank you.
Item number five, I believe, Councilor Morantz, is still regards to your ward.
So, I want to keep that, Mr. Gilliam, and I will speak to this one. Probably about a year ago or so, I got an interesting phone call from a fellow named Michael Brackett, who lives in Charleswood. And he is the grandson of John Brackett, who was Premier of Manitoba from 1922 to 1943, the longest-serving Premier in the history of the province. Yeah, a really interesting career. I'm going to read the motion, and the motion just touches on a couple of elements of his career. But not only was he premier, after he was premier of Manitoba, he became leader of the Progressive Conservative Party of Canada, and was the leader of the official opposition for several years in Ottawa. So he had a long and storied career, and the reason for Michael Bracken's call was he wanted to see if there was a way for the city to name a street in honor of John Bracken. And so this motion simply is a motion for the public service to report back to add the name to the streets reserve list for Assiniboia Community Committee. I will be making a slight amendment. I'm going to ask for the name John Bracken or Bracken, just to give flexibility when they're assessing the name, because sometimes they don't want to, the developer chooses the names. They might not want to use the full name. They might want to use the last name. So just to build in some flexibility. Now, I'm also advised by Mark Patay in PP&D that this only applies to our community committee. Are the reserve streets reserve list in our community committee. So what I asked them is if there was a way that we could have this added to the streets reserve list in the entire city. And it was interesting. He said he has never actually done that before, but he thought it would be interesting to try. So I'm not amending the motion, but based on my discussions with him, he is going to see if he can put this in front of the other community committees as well. And once it's on, assuming it gets on every streets reserve list, there'll be lots of opportunities for developers all over the city to choose the name if they would like to. So with that, I'm just going to read out the motion. Whereas John Bracken remains the longest serving premier in Manitoba history, holding the office for 21 years from 1922 to 1943 as a member of the Liberal Progressive Party. Whereas Mr. Bracken led the province through a period of tumultuous politics, the Great Depression, and much of the Second World War. And whereas Mr. Bracken served as leader of the Federal Conservative Party of Canada from 1942 to 1948 and leader of the official opposition in office from 1945 to 1948. And whereas the province of Manitoba recently made Highway 10 running 195 kilometers from the International Peace Gardens to Riding Mountain National Park, the John Bracken Highway, and whereas it would be fitting to commemorate Mr. Bracken's significant contribution to the citizens of Winnipeg. Therefore, be it resolved that the Assiniboia Community Committee recommend to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage and Downtown Development that the Winnipeg Public Service be requested to report back to the Community Committee in 60 days on the addition of the name John Bracken or, and this is the amendment, or Bracken. Or Bracken. To the Assiniboia Community Committee street name reserve list.
Okay.
So that is my motion.
Okay. I just, first of all, I want to commend you, Councilor Rantz. I think this is a very worthy, obviously, recipient and certainly a worthwhile effort. And kudos to you for responding to Mr. Bracken's grandson. And it's individuals like this, obviously, that should be we should be identifying and naming. And by naming parks, by naming streets, we really continue to perpetuate the history and the individuals, you know, in this case, Mr. Bracken's contribution to not only our whole province, but to our city as well. So I think this is an excellent and a timely initiative. So that's great.
Thank you.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
And item 6 is a walk-on. It's in your folder.
So move suspension. Someone will move suspension? Oh, for all?
Okay,
okay.
Yep.
For all. We don't have to do them individually?
No,
okay.
That's okay.
I think this, in fact, Councilor Rantz, I think the last two are in your ward.
It's a busy night for Charles with Tuxedo.
Yeah. The
So I'll leave the chair with you then, Councilor Gilliam.
Yes.
This is a per capita grant application for the Varsity View Community Club. $500 to assist with the cost of the Christmas hockey tournament for 5 and 6-year-olds from the Charleswood area, held at the Sportsplex from December 20th to 23. So I'd move that.
Okay, moved. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried.
And lastly, this is Mr. Clark. Perhaps you'll be able to walk us through this one. This is a plan approval, I believe, for a sign on the portion of the development along the north side of Sterling Line Parkway. I see just almost at, sorry, almost at Shaftesbury, I guess. Just before Shaftesbury? I had a chance to look at this briefly. On the southeast corner, which would be right on Sterling Line Parkway.
Thank you.
Basically, it only applies to the freestanding signage within the proposing site. It's a requirement as per the original subdivision and rezoning agreement on the site, and was just a requirement after they submitted an application for a variance. They need to get the property for the signage. So basically, it's a number of individual freestanding letters that combine to spell out the identification of the site.
This is a grouping of condominium.
Yeah, there's seven buildings on site. And the land is owned RMU, residential mixed use, and I think there's some intention for either some small offices or other commercial retail uses on the site.
So, what will the sign look like?
So there's actually no backing on the sign. It's really just a number of these individual posts that hold up. Letters.
Okay.
You'll be able to see right through that. I think
is it lit in any way?
Yes, there are
30 LED illuminated channel letters.
Exactly.
And this is planning is all right with this?
Yeah. They required a variance because they were going over in the sign surface area. They're good for the height. And so we were supportive of the variance because it's a rather large site with the seven multifamily buildings. And
when was the variance heard?
The scale and context. It was heard on September 21st.
So the event at the Board of
Adjustment.
Yeah. And it was approved, no appeals.
Exactly. Yeah.
So they're just here for plan approval.
Yeah.
Okay.
Quick question. LED illumination obviously complies with the level of brightness that is permitted.
Well, yeah, it has to. If we get any complaints if you're being overexposed or anything like that, we'll have someone go out, check it with a light meter, make sure that it's not glaring or creating problems from a safety perspective. But that is the requirement, and if we do hear otherwise, then we'll go out and check it.
Okay.
Okay. So, maybe just in terms of the lighting, these are residential condominiums on the site, right?
Yeah.
So there was no they had to post for the variance, and was there any opposition at the meeting?
No opposition.
There was no issues. All right. So I guess you still have the.
Yep, I do. So I'll entertain a motion.
Okay. So I'll move that we accept the sign plan.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
That's all I have.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn if you want me to just.
We'll adjourn and reconvene in a few minutes for the next hearing.
Adjourn.
5 minutes.
I'd like to reconvene this meeting of the Assiniboia Community Committee for Tuesday, October 18th, 2016. I have with me our esteemed clerk, Ms. Watt, Councillor Sean Dobson. Councillor Scott Gillingham, our planner for our community committee, Mr. Clark, and his associate, Mr. Hare, and Mr. Platt. And I'd also like to just acknowledge briefly the presence of a former councillor.
Norman.
Norman. Sorry, it's been a long day. Norman, thank you for being here. And with that, Ms. Clerk.
Okay. All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's decision or recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table just outside the door. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. This is the public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the conclusion of the public hearing, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is a plan for Red River Exhibition Park lands. Item 2 is a public hearing for a subdivision and rezoning at 3977 and 4055 Portage Avenue under file DASZ 33 of 2016. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time. Namely, item 3 is a variance at 3977 and 4055 Portage Avenue under file DAV 130922/2016D. I would ask for suspension of the rules so that any persons who have registered for this public hearing item can also be listed and included in delegation for the regular report item, which is item 1, plan for Red River Exhibition Park lands.
I move such suspension.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried.
Okay. So you have the applicant here, Councillor.
So I'd like to call up Mr. Garth Rogerson. Welcome. Just can't you to state your full name and address for our record?
My name is Garth Rogerson, 125 Riverbend Crescent in Winnipeg.
Great. Please proceed. We have you for 10 minutes.
Great. I have copies of my presentation for everybody.
Our clerk will receive them from you.
I also have overhead pictures of the property as well as some larger ones for the councillors here.
Okay.
And then, of course, the survey documents as well.
Perfect.
I want to thank the Assiniboine Community Committee for the opportunity to present tonight and for considering our proposed subdivision, rezoning, and variance applications concerning Red River Exhibition lands located at 3977 Portage Avenue and 4055 Portage Avenue. The Red River Exhibition worked closely with Kerwin Atiyah from Landmark Planning and Design on the final report in front of you, but unfortunately due to a long planned trip to Europe, Kerwin is not able to be here today. I want to take a moment to thank the Planning Department and in particular James Platt and Devin Clark for the help they provided in developing our master plan. The Red River Exhibition is not a property developer, so we would not have come this far without the help of city staff. Their attention to detail and assistance allowed us to create a plan that not only services us today, but is a document that will stand the test of time. I want to assure the committee that while today we are dealing with the subdivision rezoning and variance applications, we have prepared a long-term master plan for the 390-acre Red River Exhibition site. In addition to a precinct plan, we have also prepared studies related to design guidelines, transportation, water, sanitary sewer, and land drainage. This plan will allow the Red River Exhibition to continue its current operation while also having the opportunity to expand to meet the changing needs of the community. I would like to spend a couple of minutes and just explain to the committee how we came to this point. In 1964, the Red River Exhibition Association purchased the lands we currently occupy on the western edge of Winnipeg. Our plan has always been to develop a world-class exhibition facility, but it took until 1997 to realize our dream of opening Red River Exhibition Park. Since that time, our organization has grown to the point it's now time to launch our new plan before you tonight. This plan started over 7 years ago with a vision for the future, and we have worked closely with city planning and the various city departments for about the last 5 years. Every detail has been considered and is included in the various reports submitted with our application. The Red River Exhibition Association is unique in North America as the only federally designated Class A fair without municipal funding. While it is unheard of in our industry to not be funded by the government, we are not here to seek funding, but we are here to seek approval that will allow us to continue to be self-sustaining. The city will benefit from the tremendous economic impact we will provide, Currently, the 10 days of the Red River X provides a $16 million economic impact to the city, and it is widely believed that a fully developed park will deliver a $100 million annual economic impact to the city. Today, Winnipeg stands alone as the only major city in North America without an industrial trade show facility. Business is driving right past on its way to Regina and Saskatoon. Both national and international trade shows are not choosing Winnipeg because there simply isn't a facility to hold these shows. The Red River Exhibition can deliver a facility that will drive new business to Winnipeg, filling hotel rooms and restaurants. One show promoter I spoke to recently mentioned that he needed 1,400 hotel rooms, so it isn't hard to figure out the impact to Winnipeg of over 1,000 delegates attending a trade show. One of the big challenges of operating any sort of trade show facility is the enormous cost to build, operate, and the ongoing challenge of repairs and maintenance. In order to remain self-supporting, we plan to build a business park and participate in the development of a retail center while maintaining large parks and community spaces, which include recreational activities and an interconnecting active transportation network of paths. These developments will engage the community while providing needed year-round income and needed services for the site. The money generated from these activities will go right back into promoting Winnipeg and developing a world-class facility that will welcome the world to our city. Developing property this size is very challenging, but we've made an effort to reduce the burden on the city by limiting the need for upgrades to city infrastructure. This is a low-density development that will take over 30 years to complete. Having a master plan will allow the slow and orderly development of the property while being able to maintain the highest design standards. The master plan will allow us to build with an eye to the future so we improve the economic position of West Winnipeg and the entire city without the infrastructure burden that comes with traditional developments. Much of this development is far into the future. Some of the proposed lots will remain zoned agriculture. When those parcels are rezoned for development in the future, the community committee will have an opportunity to review our progress and decide if restrictions should be put on future development. The structure of the plan allows regular input from the city, and we plan to continue working closely with city planning and all city departments to ensure we remain an asset to the community. It should be noted that all on-site infrastructure is built and maintained by the Red River Exhibition, and even the streets surrounding our property are managed by the province, keeping costs to the city low. In the past, traffic has been an issue, so our first step in the development was to build a new major four-lane divided road to solve these and any future traffic concerns. Festival Drive opened this year at the Red River X, and there was no report of traffic problems. We tested it again this past weekend with over 13,000 people attending a trade show with no traffic issues. The enormous size of the road, along with the third lane we built on Portage Avenue, means traffic stacks on our property and not on Portage Avenue. It is very difficult to build facilities to accommodate large temporary events, but our plan addresses this, and I believe the residents of West Winnipeg will see no challenges from traffic. We are highly motivated to limit any negative impact in the city, and I believe things like the opening of Festival Drive are major steps in that direction. In the future, you will see expansion of the fairgrounds, so we not only attract significant trade shows to Winnipeg, but also deliver entertainment and recreational activities that will be tourist draw to the city. This plan provides the resources to support the facility and provide long-term sustainability. We are self-sustaining today, and with approval of this plan, we will be self-sustaining for many years to come while providing a major economic benefit to the city. Once again, I want to thank you for the opportunity this evening, and I welcome any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. Councillors, do you have any questions, Mr. Rogers?
Not so much a question. I'm kind of excited. I can't wait.
Good.
Very good plans.
Good, thank you.
I have a couple of questions. First of all, just thank you for your presentation, and I know that this has been a while in the works. I would commend the X for being self-sustaining presently, and with the goal to be self-sustaining through the future as well. Just a couple of questions, I guess, in regards to, I can ask questions about the reports as well at this time. Yeah. Okay. So just a couple of questions. I know that, for example, when it comes to the water, there's necessitates more water, a greater water supply coming in. So I'm wondering, right now, I think if I read in the report, there's a portion of your proposal that can be accommodated by the current water that's there.
That's correct.
Is that correct? That's at the corner of Racetrack Road and Portage Avenue?
We're actually not dealing with that plant tonight. That's Westport Festival. That's not part of this development.
So what you're looking at is the new line that would come in along Saskatchewan. Is that correct?
That is part of the future development of the park. Currently, that line is needed for Westport Festival development, which is not part of this plan tonight.
Okay.
But as the property develops future large-scale buildings and so forth, it would be required in the future. But our plan is to work with Shindeco and the city to install that line, and we would be funding a large portion of the cost of that based on our needs in the future.
Right, okay. So currently then, just remind me then, please, that currently the supply will be, water supply would be?
It's sufficient currently.
It's sufficient currently.
That's correct.
Okay, all right. Let's see here. I'm just wondering, you mentioned Westport Festival. Also adjacent to you, of course, is the Jockey Club and Pegasus, and that relationship is happening. They've got plans. What kind of coordination happens between the three entities, the three potential developers?
Well, certainly we're very anxious to work directly with them because, we only want to put one water line in we want to have roads in common and so forth. There's a real need to work together on that, and I believe that we could build complementary facilities that ensure that we're both successful. So there's a tremendous, and I've discussed it quite at length with city planning as well, and our interest in working cooperatively with the neighbors. But their plans are very preliminary, and so my discussions with Pegasus at this point is they're not to a point where they would be ready to discuss it.
Okay. But obviously, that kind of coordination, if you were ready to put roads in and drainage for
We sort of envision the entire area is one thing. So we've had long discussions with the Chipman family and the Auto Mall there, and of course Westport Festival. And the construction of Westport Festival is going to be built in such a way so it appears as that it's all melds together. So it's not islands of construction, and I think that's the future, is creating a complete community where everything interconnects. There's pathways, walkways, all those roadways that makes people feel that it's one joint effort.
You mentioned the roadways, that they're internal, and so they're
right.
Really yours. Are they provincial jurisdiction then?
On Portage Avenue and Saskatchewan Avenue is provincial jurisdiction, yes.
But in between, they'd be internal, so they'd be yours. So
it's private, yes.
You're private. So would it be up to the X to determine garbage collection,
That's
snow
correct.
Clearing?
That Absolutely,
city,
we do.
That would be basically
the city has no responsibility in our lands at all. We do
right.
all grass garbage collection, everything. Snow clearing.
I do know that in the plan, and this may be beyond just your plan, but the greater overall plan, there's talk about transit in future as well, transit servicing.
Right.
That. So was that specific? That's not specific to the X, or it is specific to the X, or the greater area?
No, it's, again, working jointly with all the neighbors. We've had a number of discussions with transit, and in fact, transit are putting us under pressure to move quicker on developing a transit terminal, and we've actually already started construction on a transit terminal.
Okay.
They have some challenges with how they reposition the buses in that area, and so they feel that they could use our site for repositioning buses as well as future park and ride potentially.
Okay, so not to put a timeline on you because obviously you don't know, but at what point in the Red River X development would you want to see transit in to service your lands?
Yeah, currently we pay for transit service now. We pay full charter rates for transit service, and I assume that we would continue that in the future. Transit is the one that's pursuing us to come in, and of course we would welcome that as soon as possible. Obviously, more access to the site. But transit has felt that as soon as Westport Festival starts construction, that they would like to start bringing buses, and they see potential income from that route.
Okay.
So we're working very closely with transit, and I think it's a win-win for both of us.
Okay. Just a couple more questions. Just up the road, potentially, just east of you, there, east of the Perimeter Highway, there's plans, obviously, for Centerport. So I'm wondering, is the plans that the Red River X has, I won't ask you to speak to your adjacent neighbors' plans, but the plans the X have, would you see those as somewhat competing plans or symbiotic plans to work? Because I know even though Centerport is, they're very active, even though there's some development that's yet to come, I'm just wondering if there's a, what kind of relationship there is between the X and Centerport.
Yeah, we've had a good working relationship with them as part of our consultation process. We have had a number of meetings with them. I see it as a complementary facility. We're building more office park sort of development and retail. Which really isn't something that Centerport is doing. So what it's creating is an opportunity here to attract more business to the area, more activity, and I think that would even help Centerport in developing their property as well.
Right.
And we've also studied traffic and how Centerport's...
That was my next question.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
No, that's good.
I felt it coming. We've actually studied traffic as well and how the full build-out of Centerport will impact Saskatchewan Avenue, for instance, which is a concern because of, the residents along that roadway. And so, as you can tell from our traffic study, it indicates that even at full build-out, we won't exceed the capacity of a road that was prior to when the perimeter highway was opened to Saskatchewan Avenue. So we don't see that as a major entryway to our park, but we do agree that there will be increases in traffic, but it will not exceed pre-closing of the perimeter highway.
Okay. Yeah, I was going to actually amend the report to include a traffic study until I saw that you have an extensive traffic study. So that
we actually did two. We actually went back. We did the first traffic study and then felt that there might have been some concerns that we weren't considering some of the neighboring properties like Centerport. And so we went back and StanTech did another traffic study that took those things into consideration and actually took the study all the way back to Sturgeon Road so that we could see the impact, quite a distance from the property. So very extensive studies on traffic to ensure that we're not going to, because, really, we're a community organization, and the last thing we want to do is cause hardship for the community. We want to be, in partnership with the community,
Even currently, right, when in June, when the Red River exhibition itself is on,
right,
there can be traffic challenges along Portage
right.
Avenue. So having these other access points, whether it's a racetrack
exactly.
or whatever you call it, or eventually from the north, certainly
right.
would assist with those types of events
right.
or week long festivals or events that
and that's why
have.
I brought in that picture that you have in front of you to show you the road that we built.
Yeah.
It's very extensive and very
right.
long, and it's four lane. If you look at it today, you go, man, is that overbuilt? It's so large. But we used it during the Red River X, and it pulled all the traffic off Portage Avenue. And those traffic jams that we saw in the past were non-existent.
Yeah.
Using Racetrack Road as well as Festival Drive, and as we grow, adding in the Saskatchewan entrance will pretty much, you can never eliminate traffic problems, but it will certainly reduce them significantly. And we also built a third lane on Portage Avenue, which was extremely expensive, but we felt that way improved safety because there is a safety concern with that off-ramp off of the perimeter highway to Portage Avenue. Building the third lane ensured the traffic moved smoothly and faster and entered the property more safely.
My final comment is I think, again, just express appreciation for an element of your plan when it comes to trade shows, particularly agricultural trade shows.
Right.
I mean, historically, if anyone knows the history of the city, I mean, Winnipeg has been, historically an agricultural
Absolutely.
Mecca,
right.
really a gateway to all, the prairies, which was the kind of the wheat basket of Canada for so long. So the fact that Winnipeg really doesn't have currently the capacity to host, trade shows or agricultural
right.
Conferences or displays is too bad. So to see that included in here, maybe I betrayed myself as a kid who grew up on the farm, right? But I'm certainly glad to see that.
And that's a significant focus of the development. We saw a big hole there. We are the only city in North America without a facility like that. And, Regina and Saskatoon and Calgary, they're doing fantastic with these kinds of things. And the business is driving right. It goes to Toronto, it drives right past us. So
yeah, so to compete, as a
right.
city, as an area, we really need to, as a capital,
absolutely.
We need to have
absolutely.
Okay. Those are my questions, comments.
Well, I have one other one. I see a roundabout in your picture here, and it has the western edge that goes nowhere. Is that going to go to Headland?
Well, the idea of the roundabout is for future development. We're building everything with an eye to the future. And so while we don't have any plans west of that road, you build it for the future. And so it's blocked off at this point, but at some future date from our plan, that property will be developed. But at this point, we're leaving it zoned agriculture because there is no plans. But sometime in the future, it's much less expensive to put it all in at once and then attach crossroads at that time.
Perfect.
And we have been in discussions with LADCO about interconnecting roads as well, because we do have a concern that if Headingley develops a residential, as Letco owns a number of acres there, it could cause stress on Portage Avenue and on Saskatchewan Avenue. So we're working closely with Letco to ensure that we leave space for intersecting roads that can allow residents to, you know, enter the site to go shopping or whatever they're doing without going onto Portage Avenue and Saskatchewan Avenue. So really, again, look into the future on how we can limit traffic concerns.
Yeah, sorry, I did have one other question. I talked briefly, we discussed briefly the Saskatchewan Avenue water main extension, and you indicated that's for future, not immediate, but for future. I do see it last year was carried in the 2017 capital budget. It indicates, I think, as well, that there'll be, the intention is for kind of cost recovery for the city, that the developers would pay that back. Do you have any sense, or is it too early to tell, what would be the timeline of cost recovery for the city? Has that been discussed at present?
It's hard to determine that, but we think it'll be fairly quickly, because we had planned, or Shindico had planned, to start development construction on Westport Festival this past spring, but we've had some challenges getting the servicing agreement. But construction is slated to start in the spring, and so that would mean that the city would start recouping property taxes right away. So if the water line, we're hoping, will be installed in 2017, we will spend $1.8 million to connect that line to Portage Avenue, so it loops the line, which will increase pressure and flow within all of West Winnipeg, and also provide better security of service for West Winnipeg as well. And the city will start recouping almost immediately from property taxes and water and sewer fees from that, because of the retail development. The retail development is important to us to get it going quickly, even though it's not part of this plan. It's important to get it going quickly because that's the money that we need to execute this plan. So it's a little challenging for us because of the $1.8 million cost to install the water line, and we don't particularly need it right away, but Westport Festival will need it, and it's important to the overall development. So putting in that water line early is a bit of a burden for us, but I think it'll start paying back to the city quickly, and it'll move our development forward quicker as well, because of the money that we will get from the development, and then that, of course, will drive more tax revenue for the city.
So I just want to make sure I'm clear. So the $1.8 million you're talking about, is that the cost to the X for internal?
Correct.
Waterworks? So,
that's to connect from the water main that the city will put in on Saskatchewan to the Portage Avenue connection.
Right. And so the cost recovery to the city for the because the city is fronting the $4.83 million for the water main, that would come over the course of time, you know, as the,
right. But it would start generating already from the Westport Festival site, because they are going to start construction as early as March, putting in the piles. There's a number of including residential going in there, so I think it'll be a fairly quick payback on that that water line. It's a good investment in the future, I believe.
Is there any residential? You indicate residential. That's on the Westport. Is there any residential on the X?
No, we haven't put that in the plan because it's not complementary to what we're doing.
Right.
We think that the site would be better served by servicing neighboring residential developments. You know, having cows and houses sometimes doesn't mix. So while we're not housing cows all the time, there is an expectation that there'll be livestock on the site, and so it's just not compatible to have housing. Now, we're not saying never. Certainly there is land that's going to remain zoned agriculture, and there is possibility in the future if that seems warranted. But Westport Festival is including residential within their development.
Thank you.
Great. Any further questions, councillors? No? Okay, thank you.
Good, thank you.
Next registered in support, I have Sherry Rogerson. Sherry Rogerson wants to come forward. Just registered in support. Thank you. Next registered in support is Marlene Baskerville. Would Marlene Baskerville like to come forward and speak? No? Just registered in support. Great. Registered in support, Eleanor Castles. Eleanor, would you like you're in support? Great, thank you. Michael, all of these are in support. Michael Gallagher?
Yeah, support.
In support? Great, thank you. Laura Holtman. Is Laura Holtman here?
In
support. Registered in support. Jody Johnson.
Yep, in support?
Okay. Donna Nentwig. Thank you. Larry Nentwig.
Yes.
Same? Okay. Les Newman.
In support.
In support? Okay, great. Thank you. Looks like KKN Pienkowski. In support? Great. Thank you. Peter Sinch. Sinchich. How do you say it?
Sinichich.
Sinichich. Okay, thank you. Tom Tolton.
In support.
Thank you. Judy Worthington.
In support.
In support. Great. Roland Ray.
In support.
In support. Okay, that's everyone in support. Is there anyone here in support who has not filled out a form who would like to acknowledge their here in support? Ms. Nordman, I see first time, and I've been here for 2 years. It's the first time anyone's done that. So
he wouldn't know the process.
He probably didn't know. Would you like to say anything, Mr. Nordman?
Just congratulations. It's a great project.
Great. Thank you. We haven't received any forms registered in opposition,
no.
But should I
just ask?
Is there anyone here in opposition who has not filled out a form that would like to register in opposition at this time? I see none. Is there anyone here for information? I see none.
I don't know if you wanted to ask the administration questions before you call the applicant back up if you
choose. Sure. Councillors, do you have any questions for administration at this point?
Not present. I mean, it's a comprehensive report, and maybe I'll take an opportunity just to, at this point, to acknowledge. I mean, when you look at the volume of work, I know that's your job. I get that, but your job is also to liaise often and work very closely with developers such as Mr. Rogerson and others. So, I just want to acknowledge the work that you've done as well as a team and the work you'll continue to do. Mr. Chair, I also certainly want to acknowledge the work Mr. Rogerson and his team have done, and I also want to acknowledge previous Councillor Nordman, because this started quite some time ago when he was serving as the councillor of that ward, and he and the community committee that predates us, Councillor Fielding was involved in that as well, Councillor Havocbeck. I know there was a lot of work done, and so I want to acknowledge them at this time, because what we have before us didn't happen overnight. It offers a lot of economic potential to our city and to our community, including opportunity not only to attract groups here and conferences and trade shows here, and therefore sell hotel rooms and restaurants, but I mean the potential number of individuals that could be employed on these grounds as well is significant, not only now but through the coming years. So that's not I don't think we lose sight of that as we have this these reports before us today. So I just want to make those comments at this time, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Gillingham. I will echo your sentiments that you've expressed, so I don't need to say it.
Okay.
Thank you. The applicant, Mr. Rogerson, is welcome to come back as part of the process to provide any further comments.
I think everything's been covered, unless there's any further questions.
Councillors, do you have any further questions for Mr. Rogerson?
No, everything's been covered four times over.
I have no questions. Yeah, I would just say great work.
Good, thank you.
Okay, then. So unless there are any other comments or questions, would anyone like to... I guess we have to deal with these separately, three separate motions.
Yeah, so we'll do the plan first, which is report item one.
So...
We will. That'll be the last one.
Okay.
So we're just doing the regular report first, the plan report. Yeah. That one. So it's just a regular item, Councillor, so there's no public hearing deal in that.
So there's nothing.
All right. I'm just saying. Just motion for plan approval.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you can just concur.
I concur with the administration on that.
Okay, we have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on that matter that will now proceed to property and development and council.
And report number two is the subdivision and rezoning application.
So it's that one. So yep. If you go.
There we go.
Let's go to the.
Okay, well, if I'd like to make a motion on it, unless someone wants to speak on it?
No, feel free to proceed.
Okay, that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye. Okay.
Carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried.
That the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to...
You can go to EPC.
Via?
Via the priority rezoning
process.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
And one thing I can say since being in this office, that this project has been on, I wasn't aware of it prior, but it's been on there, and it's been a great project to see.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's another portion to the motion moved by Councillor Reason, right?
Yeah, I think this is his supporting. This is your supporting.
Just supporting.
Yeah. Okay, so just the project is great for the area? Yeah.
It's great for the area. It's great for the city.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
That the public hearing with this respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
There we go.
Good job. All right. Next up, we have the variance application.
I'd like to make a motion if...
Oh, please.
Is it ready?
Yeah.
That the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
That in accordance with subsection 247.3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan of Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan and does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. My comments are very similar to the previous ones, so I think...
Same as the zoning.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carry.
That the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred and the variance be approved.
All in favor?
Aye.
That Carried. The public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
So, please note that the committee has made a decision on the subdivision and rezoning, and the matter will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted, and all persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is considered by council. For the variance, please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Yes, there's no further business. May I have
move adjournment?
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. We are adjourned.
That first one for the plan, that's the right time. It holds me off.